Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AIS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and the page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the description box and also in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let us move on to the analysis of first news article. Today is 70th Constitution Day, that is November 26, 2019. It is the 70th anniversary of the adoption of Indian Constitution by the Constituent Assembly. Know that every year 26th November is celebrated as Constitution Day, which is also known as Samvidhan Divas. That is why the lead editorial in today's The Hindu newspaper is dedicated to praise or to hail the fundamental law of the land based on which India is constituted and governed. That is, since the adoption of this fundamental law of the land, it has endured till now and it has the means to sustain furthermore. In this context, we'll be discussing the editorial article. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this editorial has been given here for your reference. Indian Constitution is one of the world's oldest constitutions and it is also one of the most enduring constitutions as it enters into the 70th year of existence, or the 70th anniversary. At the time of birth of Indian Constitution, the constitutional experts around the world did not expect or they did not predict that Indian Constitution will survive a longer period of time in terms of number of years. The author of this editorial mentions that one of the most incisive critics or one of the sharp critics with respect to Indian Constitution at that period of time was Sir Ivor Jennings. At that time, he was the world's leading expert on constitutional matters and constitutional law. In 1951, he was invited to University of Madras to deliver a series of lectures on the newly born Indian Constitution. What he mentioned was Indian Constitution was far too large and it is also too rigid. And he felt that therefore it will be really difficult to mold Indian Constitution into something useful, even though by judicious interpretations. Overall, his judgment was that Indian Constitution would not endure or would not sustain for a long time. Now, this author has termed the comments made by Ivor Jennings as a premature analysis. This is because, contrary to his perceptions, Indian Constitution has survived almost 70 years since its adoption. To emphasize the enduring capacity of Indian Constitution, the author has quoted a research study carried out by University of Chicago. This research study is titled as The Lifespan of Written Constitutions by Thomas Ginsburg, Zachary Elkins, and James Melton. This study is about the longevity of constitutions around the world. The author tells that this study has covered the constitutional history of every independent state from 1789 to 2006. The author mentions that the study has also found out noticeable variations across generations and regions. He has also mentioned mean lifespan in different geographical regions. And this information has been presented here for our viewers and subscribers. And know that irrespective of these average years mentioned here, Indian Constitution stands out as we can see through our experience with Indian Constitution. This study mentions that in general, constitutions do not last for a very long time. It found that the mean lifespan of constitutions across the world is just 17 years. So comparing to this mean lifespan given by the study, Indian Constitution stands far better in terms of other constitutions. Now let's see a question. What will generally the constitutions do? The most important function of the constitution is to ring fence. That is, it will guarantee the power. At the same time, it will limit the power of authorities through various restrictions. Then the constitution also defines a nation and its goals. In terms of Indian constitution, our goals are enshrined in preamble, and more particularly, it also can be seen in directive principle of state policy. Constitution also defines patterns of authority and it provides provisions to set up government institutions. If you take Indian Constitution, it talks about Office of President, Prime Minister, Council of Ministers, Election Commission, Union Public Service Commission, and various other authorities, even Supreme Court, High Court, etc. So these are some of the important functions of Constitution as mentioned by the author in this editorial. Generally, we say Constitution as a fundamental law of the land based on which a state, a nation state, is constituted and governed. Then the author discusses about primary mechanisms by which constitutional changes take place. As we know already, one mechanism is through formal amendments to the Constitution. Here, when we say formal amendments, we refer to the procedure in which amendments take place in the Parliament based on the provisions of Constitution. An amendment bill is introduced in one of the houses of Parliament, then it goes to next house, then it is passed in both houses, then it receives the assent of President, then an amendment is effected in the Constitution. This we refer to formal amendment. There is also a concept of informal amendments. We are reading news that Supreme Court has struck down this section in a particular law. Similarly, Supreme Court can strike down a provision in the Constitution also because it has the power of judicial review. One main example that happened recently is with respect to Article 124, Capital A of Indian Constitution. This article was introduced by an amendment made by Parliament, but Supreme Court struck down this article by its authority of judicial review. This is one of the reasons why we say in India, Parliament is sovereign, but at the same time, judiciary is supreme. So these are the two primary mechanisms based on which constitutional changes are effected. Next, the author discusses about what are the factors that determine constitutional lifespan. Here, when we say lifespan, it is nothing but the time period the Constitution will survive. It is also called as longevity of constitution. The threats that are faced by a particular country, say in terms of war or civil war or some extraordinary crisis that may lead to breakup of a country, these factors have a strong effect with respect to lifespan of a constitution. Then the next factor that will determine the lifespan is the structural attributes of the constitution. For example, how lengthy the constitution is. For example, how detailed manner the constitutional provisions are and the enforceability of the constitution. Then the adaptability or whether the provisions in the constitution can be modified or not. These factors also determine the lifespan of the constitution. Here the constitution has clearly mentioned with respect to enforcing fundamental rights under Article 32, one can directly approach for constitutional remedy to the Supreme Court, and under Article 226, one can approach High Court for remedies. And with respect to adaptability, with respect to modifying the provisions to take into account the changed situations, we have absolute majority for certain provisions, we have effective majority to amend constitution with respect to certain provisions, then we have special majority, and then we have simple majority for certain kind of amendments. Then the structural attributes of a state can also determine the constitutional lifespan. Here, when we say structural attributes, this could mean the supremacy of Indian judiciary, the sovereignty of the parliament, the powers of parliament and state legislatures, all these factors. Then the specificity of the document also plays a very important role. Here, under specificity, we may cite the example of Schedule 7 of Indian Constitution, wherein Constitution has clearly delineated separation of powers with respect to subjects that comes under union list or state list or concurrent list. In the absence of such specificity, there could be threats to the survival of the Constitution. Then the important factor is inclusiveness of the origin of the Constitution. It means when the Constitution is being framed, it should take into account the concerns of all sections of Indian society, including minorities. So when a constitution is framed in an inclusive manner, it is more likely that a constitution will survive for a longer period of time. But of all these factors, the ability to adapt to changing conditions will be a important factor when we predict longevity of a constitution. In the next part of the editorial, the author has explained why India's constitution is stable. First reason he mentions is that the fractionalized environment in India, that is the presence of more groups in Indian society in terms of religion, in terms of ethnicity, in terms of language, this has ensured that no single group can dominate on other groups. Therefore, it is one of the most important reasons why Indian Constitution is a stable document, because it is inclusive in nature. It takes the concerns of diverse societies in Indian society. Then the length of Indian Constitution, herein we are actually meaning the detailed and specific manner in which Constitution has given various provisions. So end of the day, a Constitution has to be relatively detailed and elaborate. At the same time, it should be having enough provisions to modify to take into account the changing required conditions. The author mentions that it is impressive how the drafting committee of Indian Constitution have addressed almost all the concerns to make sure Indian constitution will withstand the test of time and will be a enduring constitution. Because at that time in 1940s, the drafting committee of Indian constitution do not have such a research study so as to guide how to proceed with drafting Indian constitution so as to make it an enduring constitution. So in this context, let us see a few information with respect to the drafting committee from the prelims point of view. See, the Constituent Assembly has met for the first time in Delhi on 9th December 1946. On 29th August 1947, by way of a resolution, the Constituent Assembly has appointed a drafting committee. The purpose was to draft the Indian Constitution. It had 7 members, and on 30th August 1947, immediately, that is the next day of appointing a committee, the drafting committee elected B.R. Ambedkar as its chairman. The other members are Krishnasamy, Gopalaswamy, Munsi, Mohammad Sadullah, Mitter and Keitan. Here the news article has mentioned about Mr. Krishnasamy as one of the chief architects of the drafting committee with respect to Indian constitution. The drafting committee has completed the work of drafting the constitution of India, and finally on 26th November 1949, 70 years before this day, Constitution of India was adopted, and it came into force on the Republic Day of India, that is on 26 January 1950. On that day, that is on 26 Jan 1950, the Constituent Assembly stopped to exist. It then transformed itself into a provisional parliament of India till a new parliament was constituted in the year 1952. So this is about the history of the drafting committee, which played a very important role in drafting or in making the Indian constitution as an enduring constitution. Then the author mentions that along with inclusiveness, specificity, the constitution provides an excellent balance between redundant verbosity and confounding ambiguity. Herein the author mentions that constitution makers has avoided repetition of provisions and also avoided confusing provisions. Then the author mentions about two anchors as sheet anchors to the constitution. One is the fundamental rights guaranteed under part 3 of constitution, then the judicial review guaranteed in the constitution. Sheet anchors, the term used by the author to represent that these will act as safeguards, particularly in times of emergencies or any exigency. Then finally, the author concludes the editorial article by quoting the words made by judge from United States, Justice Oliver Wendell, who stated that the life of a law has not been logic, it has been experience. Here the experience refers to the experience of makers of Indian constitution with respect to the plurality, with respect to diversity that was present in the Indian society. So it does not go through some mathematical logic like the constitution has to be shorter or longer or anything like that. It has to be based on experience so as to withstand the test of time. So these are some of the very important points that are discussed by the author on the 70th anniversary of adoption of Indian constitution. With this discussion, we urge you to read the salient features of Indian constitution given in the Indian Polity book written by Mr. Lakshmikant. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this lead editorial article. This news article talks about conservation of a freshwater turtle in Assam by using cultural identity. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. The news article talks about gamusas as cultural identity of the people living in the state of Assam. Now, these gamusas are also called as gamochas. What are these? These are actually hand-woven white cotton towel, but it has red color border with floral decorative designs, or in other words, with floral motifs. These gamusas are recognizable cultural symbols of people from Assam, and they are saying that it is also an integral part of most of the socio-religious ceremonies in Assam. And one important fact here is that recently Assamese gamusa has received the GI tag or the geographical indication tag. Now environmentalists and turtle conservationists, they have decided to use this cultural identity to aid conservation of endangered turtles, particularly Assam roof turtles. They are using gamusas which are woven with turtle images so as to spread the conservation message with respect to rare freshwater turtles. This project taken by the people in the state of Assam has been assisted by several international NGOs, for example, Wildlife Conservation Society, Turtle Survival Alliance, and the measures are also funded by funding agencies such as Disney Wildlife Conservation Fund and some others. See, these conservation efforts are mainly taking place in Biswanath Wildlife Division in Kaziranga National Park. In 2018, the internal map of Kaziranga National Park was divided into two divisions. One is the Eastern Assam Wildlife Division, which is also called as Southern Division within the Kaziranga National Park. And the other is Biswanath Wildlife Division, which is also called as Northern Division. Classifying the park into two divisions was done to ensure better conservation of high biodiversity in both the divisions, particularly in Biswanath Wildlife Division. If you see, one of the threats faced by the freshwater turtles in Assam is that when people go for fishing in rivers, incidentally or accidentally, turtles are also captured. As a result, the number of turtles living in riverine ecosystems are decreasing. As a result, in protected areas, for example, in national parks and some other areas, there are restrictions so that fishing should not take place. But this has affected the livelihood and income of fishing-dependent communities to a great extent. But the people who have engaged in the conservation using the cultural identity of gamusas, they have decided that the revenue generated by selling gamusas with woven with turtle images and few other handloom products, these revenue generated will be used for providing financial assistance to the affected fishing dependent communities. At the same time, part of the revenue generated will also be used for conservation of rare turtles, rare freshwater turtles, for example, Assam roofed turtle. Now let's see few information related to Assam roofed turtle. It's a small freshwater turtle. It primarily occurs in running waters, particularly in the hills of northeastern India in Assam and northeastern and southeastern Bangladesh. If you see this image, these are the pockets in which the Assam roof turtles are distributed. Now, coming to the threats faced by these turtles, one is that logging of forests or deforestation. As a result, soil stability is lost and it leads to siltation of rivers. That is one major threat faced by this turtle. And then these turtles are also captured for food, poaching. And then there is also pet trade. And as we saw already, incidental or accidental capture in fishing gear is also one major problem. Now let's conclude this news article by discussing the conservation status of this Assam roof turtle. If you see IUCN Red List, it comes under endangered category that requires much attention. In sites, it comes under Appendix 2. And in case of Indian laws, that is in Indian Wildlife Protection Act, it is protected in the highest level, that is under Schedule 1 of WPA 1972. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next news article. This news article is about the recent development with respect to non-banking financial companies in terms of resolution process. When we say non-banking financial company, it is a company that is registered under Companies Act. This company is engaged in the business of loans and advances. It is engaged in acquisition of stocks, shares, bonds, debentures, and securities that are issued by government or local authority or any other marketable securities similar to government securities. But here we have to note that NBFCs do not include any institution whose principal business is agricultural activity or industrial activity, or whose principal business is purchase or sale of goods or providing any services and purchase and sale of immovable property. So the non-banking financial companies, they lend and make investments, and therefore it appears that their activities are similar to that of banks. Then what way NBFCs differ from banks? See, NBFCs cannot accept demand deposits, whereas banks can. And NBFCs will not become part of payment and settlement system, and they cannot issue checks drawn on itself. And in case of banks, there is availability of deposit insurance facility of Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation. This facility is not available for the depositors of non-banking financial companies. So these are the ways in which NBFCs differ from banks. In the recent years, we have seen several financial crises with respect to several non-banking financial companies. One particular company which almost provided shocks for the economy in 2018 is the Infrastructure Leasing and Financial Services Company, shortly called as ILNFS. Now, one of the recent ones suffering crisis is the Devan Housing Finance Corporation Limited, shortly called as DHFL. As a response to tackling the crisis in non-banking financial companies, the government has used its power under Section 227 of IBC Code 2016. So by using this power, the central government has decided to include non-banking financial companies under the insolvency and resolution processes as mandated by IBC Code 2016. See, this Section 227 is called as an enabling provision to bring various entities into the ambit of IBC. This section mentions that the central government may, if it considers necessary, in consultation with appropriate financial sector regulators, it can bring financial service providers or categories of financial service providers under the ambit of IBC for the purpose of insolvency and liquidation proceedings. So on 18th November, government has issued a notification which has mentioned that non-banking financial companies with an asset size of ₹500 crore or more than ₹500 crore, they can be brought under IBC Code 2016 if they are facing financial crisis. This means the debt-ridden NBFCs can now undergo resolution processes as per the provisions of IBC. Therefore, those banks who have given a lot of money to stressed NBFCs will now be able to get their money back because of the resolution processes under IBC. So now let's see the news article. The news article mentions that the largest lenders to non-banking financial companies in India are the Indian banks. So when an NBFC is stressed, it makes the banks to stress more. So when an NBFC defaults, it adversely affects the balance sheet of banks also, because the non-performing assets will increase for banks. So before the 18th November notification, the only framework available for stressed NBFCs was liquidation. Now, liquidation is a process of bringing a business to an end. This can be done by selling the assets of the particular business entity or a non-banking financial company in an open market. But when we bring it under the ambit of IBC, by having successful resolution, a debt-ridden company can be made to run continuously. However, it will be ensured under the company which takes over the debt-ridden company. Therefore, more than liquidation, a successful resolution under IBC code gives much promise and hope to the economy, particularly in terms of damage minimization. The news article mentions that the current move by the government is a credit positive for Indian banks. They're using the term credit positive because of bringing the NBFCs under the ambit of IBC code. This means now the money given to NBFCs have much lesser risk compared to the previous time. Say, if you take for example, DHFL is the first NBFC to come under the IBC process. Now, sources are saying that this NBFC is unable to pay a debt of around 90,000 crore. Now, under the resolution process in IBC, the best bidder offering maximum amount will take over this DHFL. Now, under successful resolution, the company which takes over will provide the money given by banks back to the banks. Such kind of resolution is important because now banks will give more money to NBFCs because there is less credit risk as NBFCs are brought under the ambit of IBC. Now, according to the notification, the regulator in this case is the Reserve Bank of India. Therefore, RBI from now on will analyze the financial conditions of stressed NBFCs and those NBFCs with severe liquidity crisis or solvency crisis, they will be taken to IBC processes. So by this, the recent move will ensure better governance of non-banking financial companies. And the recent step by the central government is also considered as a first step in bringing other systematically important financial institutions into the ambit of IBC. Here, when we say other systematically important financial institutions, we mean to say about banks, insurance companies, and those financial institutions which are too big to fail, or those companies whose failure may trigger a huge financial crisis in the economy. So these are some of the important points with respect to the recent move taken by the central government by using the enabling provision, Section 227 of IBC 2016. So the action of the government is in the right direction, as it will improve the financial governance and it will also have a strong bearing on securing stability of the economy. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. These news articles are with respect to Hong Kong. This news article mentions that the democracy backers sweep Hong Kong polls. In the analysis, we'll see the geographical perspective of Hong Kong, then a brief historical view with respect to Hong Kong and also its one country, two systems rule, then economic importance of Hong Kong and also present issues in Hong Kong and the impact of elections of district councils for future democratic reforms. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. See, Hong Kong is located on the south coast of China. It is a metropolis on the southern coast of China, overall in the East Asian region. When we say Hong Kong, it includes the Hong Kong Island, the Kowloon Peninsula, and it also includes 200 smaller islands. And almost all of the available land in Hong Kong is quite hilly in nature. And note that neither Tropic of Cancer nor the equator passes through Hong Kong. Now we'll see the historical perspective on a short note. Human activity in Hong Kong, it goes back to around 5,000 years ago. And there were early influences from Chinese Stone Age cultures from the north. This was about ancient times, but in modern history, if you see, British East India Company reached China in 1699 by making their first successful sea venture to China. From then, the trade between Hong Kong and British merchants has developed rapidly. But since 1842 till 1997, Hong Kong was ruled by Britain. This is because in 1842, Britain defeated Chinese in the First Opium War. See, this First Opium War happened during the years 1839 to 1842. And in the end, in 1842, Britain emerged as a winner after the defeat of China. And under the treaty called as Treaty of Nanking, Hong Kong was ceded to Britain. And from then, the British continued to rule Hong Kong till 1997. There is one another opium war called as Second Opium War, which happened in the 19th century. The time duration is 1856 to 1860. This war was against China. The forces fought against China were British and French. There is one common feature among the First Opium War and the Second Opium War. In both these wars, the foreign powers were victorious. Now come to 1997. Based on an agreement between England and China, in 1997, China assumed sovereignty over Hong Kong by a principle called as One Country, Two Systems principle. Under this principle, Hong Kong became a special administrative region of the People's Republic of China. Hong Kong had autonomy with respect to all matters except foreign affairs and defense. So under this principle, Hong Kong can have independent legal systems and independent law and order mechanisms, that is police forces, but it will not have any powers with respect to foreign affairs or defense. Now in comparison to the scenario before 1997, the political structures in Hong Kong varied a little. The variation is that earlier governors were sent by the colonial power, but now there are local chief executives. These chief executives will replace governors sent by the colonial power. Hong Kong was officially made a part of China since 1997, whereas Macau became a part of China in the year 1999. See, Hong Kong was handed over by Britain, whereas Macau was handed over by Portuguese in the way similar to Hong Kong, how it was handed over under the principle called as One Country, Two Systems. See, China has 23 provinces, 5 autonomous regions, one of them is Tibet Autonomous Region. Then it has 4 municipalities direct under the control of central government, and it has 2 special administrative regions. Hong Kong is one and the other is Macau. Now, according to the constitutional document of Hong Kong Special Administrative Region, the present political arrangement has to remain in effect for 50 years from 1997. Now, this constitutional document of Special Administrative Region of Hong Kong is also called as the Basic Law. So in terms of rights and freedoms of people in Hong Kong, these are based on impartial rule of law and independent judiciary, and the head of the government of Hong Kong is known as Chief Executive. Now this Chief Executive or the head of government of Hong Kong would be elected by an indirect election, and the candidates who are to stand for the election has to be approved by the Chinese government. And this chief executive will preside over a system that is in Hong Kong. It's roughly modeled on Britain's system, but it has only one legislative chamber. Unlike in India where we have 2 houses, therefore we call Indian as a bicameral legislature system. One of the promises of China with respect to chief executive is that eventually, gradually in the end, they will be elected by universal adult suffrage. But till now, they are being elected by indirect election only. So the political arrangements, when they are to last for 50 years from 1997, what will happen after 2047 is still unclear. Now let's see a few information related to Hong Kong in terms of economic perspective. If you see Hong Kong's economy, it is characterized by low taxation, minimum government intervention, and its significant trading partner is the mainland China. Here, Hong Kong's economy is dominated in the services sector rather than the production or manufacturing sector. So what is about the various issues that are happening in Hong Kong for the last 6 months? People in Hong Kong are protesting against a controversial legislation called as extradition bill. This bill seeks to extradite persons in Hong Kong to places where the city does not have any extradition agreements. The main contention is that if such a bill becomes an enforceable legislation, those who criticize the Chinese government, they might be extradited to China, where the judicial system is perceived to be favoring the ruling Communist Party. So this extradition bill is seen as a forceful move of the Chinese government to restrict the freedom of speech and expression. This is how it was perceived by the people in Hong Kong. However, because of the protest, the chief executive of Hong Kong has suspended the extradition bill. And very recently, elections were conducted to the district councils, and this district council are part of local governance in Hong Kong. And according to the editorial article, it mentions that around 29 lakh people have turned up for the election, and it represents 71.2% of electorate. That means the voter turnup was around 70%. And if you see the election in 2015, it was just 47%. This shows the interest of the people in Hong Kong in the election process. And if you see the results, it showed that the pro-democracy parties have won in around 17 out of the 18 councils, out of the 18 district councils. If you take all the district councils, the total membership is 452. Earlier, close to 300 seats were controlled by the establishment parties, meaning the parties supporting China. But after the recent election, around 392 out of 452 seats were won by pro-democracy parties. So the election results show that the people in Hong Kong are supporting greater autonomy and full democracy for Hong Kong. And they have also expressed their anger against the existing government in Hong Kong and also the Chinese government through the election process. Here, when we say greater autonomy, when we say full democracy, one of the main demand of people of Hong Kong is that chief executive of Hong Kong has to be directly elected by universal adult franchise, not by indirectly elected. You can compare the situation of election of chief executive with the way and manner in which the president of India is elected. If you see the editorial today, even it has also raised the important question whether the election results will put more pressure on the government of the day to take more conciliatory approach to resolve the ongoing crisis. One way of doing that is by offering to talk with the protesters so as to seek common ground to end the violence and to restore law and order in the city as soon as possible. So the system in Hong Kong will evolve based on the recent informal reactions and formal reactions by the people of Hong Kong. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of these news articles. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. Now, this question is with reference to Assam roofed turtle. They have given three statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, it is a freshwater turtle. Now this statement is correct. See, it is a small freshwater turtle that occurs primarily in the running waters, that is primarily in the river waters, in the hills of northeastern India in Assam. And they are also found in the running waters in northeastern and southeastern Bangladesh. So this means the second statement, it is found only in the Indian state of Assam, is incorrect. First statement is correct. Second statement is incorrect. So the moment you find second statement is incorrect, you can eliminate option B and option D. Now you have to check whether the third statement is correct or wrong. It states that it comes under critically endangered category in the IUCN Red List. Now, this statement is wrong because it comes under endangered category. However, in the future, if the threats faced by this rare species increases, maybe because of siltation, because of deforestation, maybe because of capturing or poaching this turtle for food, or because of pet trade or capture in fishing gear, if these threats increases in future, maybe it could come under critically endangered category after the assessment by IUCN. But as of now, it is in endangered category. So at the end, statement 2 and 3 are incorrect. So the correct answer is option A, 1 only. Now this question is with reference to non-banking financial companies. They have given 3 statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. Now the first statement, NBFCs include any institution whose principal business is that of agriculture activity, industrial activity, purchase or sale of any goods, or providing any services and construction of immovable property. Now, according to the definition given by Reserve Bank of India, this statement is incorrect because NBFCs will not perform agriculture activity or industrial activity or purchase or sale of any goods or providing services or construction of immovable property as principal business. So the first statement is incorrect. But if you know that the first statement is surely wrong, immediately you can arrive at the correct answer by eliminating options A, C and D. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 and 3 only. Now come to the second statement. The central government, in consultation with the RBI, can bring a financially stressed NBFC with an asset size of 500 crore or more under Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Now this statement is correct because according to section 227, the central government may, in consultation with appropriate financial regulators, it could bring a certain financial service provider under the ambit of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. So according to that section, this statement becomes correct. Now the third statement, section 227 of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code enables the center to bring financial service providers under IBC for the purpose of insolvency and liquidation proceedings. Now this statement is correct. Usually you may not see a prelims question based on sections. Here we have given this as a third statement for the purpose of revision, as section 227 is an enabling provision. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 and 3 only, because second and third statements are correct. Now this is a easy question. One country, two systems, often seen in news, refers to. The correct answer for this question is option C, Hong Kong. This question comes part of current events of international importance in terms of syllabus. In UPSC 2018, there was a question. The term two-state solution, sometime mentioned in the news, is in the context of. The correct answer for that question is Israel. So the syllabus events of international importance has to be given due attention. Now let's come to the mains question. The Constitution of India is an enduring document of governance. Discuss. Here you can begin by saying that the average lifespan of constitutions across the world is 17 years, according to a research study conducted by University of Chicago. In terms of this research, Indian constitution has performed far better by reaching almost 70 years and still counting. Since they have asked to discuss, you could mention various factors that have enabled the Indian constitution to stand the test of time. See, a constitution is nothing but a fundamental law of the land based on which the nation state is constituted and governed. In this context, Indian constitution defines patterns of authority and it also sets up important government institutions in our country. And Indian constitution is inclusive in nature because it addresses the needs of diverse sections of the society without discrimination. Article 15 of Indian constitution states that there shall be no discrimination in terms of religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth. With respect to right to freedom of religion for various communities, the right to freedom of religion has become a part of fundamental right under Part 3 of Indian Constitution. As a result, there may not be communal tensions threatening the life of Constitution. Then you can discuss about the specificity, which is another important factor that has enabled Indian Constitution to live long, because the more specific the provisions are, there is less ambit for interpretation. In terms of separation of powers, you can, in terms of one example you could cite is Schedule 7 of Indian Constitution, where there is separation of powers between the Union and the states, and there is also a concurrent list. While Indian Constitution has been criticized, it is one of the lengthiest constitution. We could say that it is a detailed constitution subject to less interpretations. And for a constitution to survive a long period of time, the governance of a country is important, particularly with respect to containing the secessionist or centrifugal or insurgency tendencies that arise from some of the sections of the country. In this regard, India has effectively contained secessionist tendencies among various communities and is doing a great job with respect to that matter. For example, you could mention the effective containment of Sikh militancy, containment of insurgencies in northeastern regions, and others. One of the most important factors that will decide the lifespan of a constitution is the amount of flexibility and the amount of rigidity with which a constitution can be amended. Indian constitution guarantees this by giving varying degrees in terms of amending the constitution. We have absolute majority for some provisions, effective majority is applicable. For some provisions, special majority, for example, Article 368 of Indian constitution, and for federal provisions, even the consent of the states are required to amend the constitution. So this ensures that the constitution adapts itself to the changing conditions based on requirement judicially and effectively. While this is with respect to the formal mechanism to amend the constitution, informally and also judicially recognized method of amending the constitution is by the power of judicial review, which rests with the Supreme Court. See, the Supreme Court is the final arbiter of the constitution. Whenever there is requirement of interpretation of constitution, a constitutional bench is set up based on Article 145, Clause 3 of Indian constitution to determine what is exact interpretation of the constitution. Then you can say that while the constitution sets up various authorities by having elaborate provisions, it also adds to ring fencing. That is, it also restricts the powers. One of the main provision by which the constitution has restricted the power of government is by having a written framework of fundamental rights. Then for concluding the answer, you may say that one of the important constitutional experts in 1950s and 1940s, Sir Ivor Jennings, has criticized the Indian constitution that it will not sustain for a long period of time. In fact, he also wrote a constitution for Ceylon, but it did not withstand even more than 6 years. So the foresight and the enlightenment and the vision and the wisdom of makers of Indian constitution is far better and far ahead of time to make the fundamental law of India an enduring document. So these are some of the points that you can add in the answer writing of this question. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share, and subscribe to Shankar AIS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation. We'll meet you tomorrow.